Hello everyone, welcome back to the fourth session of sexual reproduction on flowering plants. Pollination, it is the transfer of pollen grains from the anther to the stigma of a pistil. And here the pollen grains are transferred from anther to stigma through style. Here both male and female are non-motile. In this picture, you can see that pollen grains are not only transferred from the anther, they are also transferred from some agents like wind, insect, etc., etc. Autogamy, it is one of the form of self-pollination. In this, pollen grains transfer from the anther to stigma of the same flower. In flowers with exposed anthers and stigma, complete autogamy is rare. Autogamy in such flowers requires synchrony in pollen release and stigma receptivity. Also, anther and stigma should lie close to each other. Plants like viola, it's also known as a common pansy, oxalis and camina produces two types of a flowers. Autogamy is produces two types of flowers. One is chasmogamous flower, another is clistogamous flower. Chasmogamous flowers, they are similar to flowers of other species with exposed anthers and stigma. Clistogamous flowers, they do not open at all. Anthers and stigma lie close to each other. They are autogamous. When anthers dehisce in the flower bud, pollen grains come in contact with stigma for pollination. Clistogamous flowers produces a shrewd seed set even in the absence of pollinators. Gytogamy. In this, pollen grains transfer from the anther to stigma of another flower of the same point. It is functionally cross-pollination involving a pollinating agent, but it is genetically similar to autogamy since the pollen grains comes from the same plant. Xenogamy. In this, pollen grains transfer from the anther to stigma of a different plant. It brings genetically different pollen grains to the stigma. Agents of pollination. I already told you that pollination maybe takes place from biotic factor also, abiotic factor also. From the abiotic factor might be wind and water will involve. From the biotic factor, some insects will be involved. The flowers produces enormous amount of a pollen. The pollen grains are light and non-sticky so that they can be transported in wind currents. They often possess well-exposed stamens for easy depression of pollens into wind currents. Large feathery stigma to trap airborne pollen grains. Usually these kind of a pollen grains are non-sticky and colorless in nature. The inflorescence is spikelet. Best example for anemophily is maize. Maize is best example for spikelet inflorescence. Here in this picture you can see the feathery anthers, that is nothing but a jute. In Kannada you can say that juttu. In maize, mekkejola or govinjola you can call it as. So this one is consisting of a spikelets and non-sticky feathery anthers that will transfer through wind and helps in the pollination. Hydrophily. Pollination takes place in water. It is quite rare. It is limited to about 30 genera, mostly monocotyledons. You know that water is classified into fresh and marine water. Freshwater pollination, example, Vallisneria and Hydrilla. Marine water, seagrasses and Joustera. As against this, water is regular mode of transport for the male gametes among the lower plants. It is believed, particularly for some bryophytes and pteridophytes, that their distribution is limited because of the need for water for the transport of male gametes and fertilization. In Vallisneria, the female flowers reaches the surface of water by the long stalk and the male flowers or pollen grains are released on the surface of water. They are carried by water currents and reach the female flowers. In seagrasses, female flowers remain submerged in water. Pollen grains are long and ribbon-like. They are carried inside the water and reach the stigma. The pollen grains of most of the water-pollinated species have mucilaginous covering to protect from wetting. Not all aquatic plants use hydrophylla. In most of aquatic plants, the flowers emerge above the level of water for entomophily and anemophily. Wind and water pollinated flowers are not very colorful and do not produce nectar. Look at this picture here, Vallisneria and seagrass plants, how the male and female plants are gone to pollination, how they are involving in water source. Entomophily. Pollination takes place by insects. Majority of flowering plants use animals as pollinating agent. Example, bees, butterflies, flies, beetles, wasps, ants, moths, birds, bats, primates, arboreals, rodents, reptiles, etc. etc. Pollination by insects, particularly bees, is more common. Often flowers of animal pollinated plants are specifically adapted for particular species of animals. Large, colorful, fragrant and rich in nectar. Nectar and pollen grains are the floral rewards for pollination. When the flowers are small, they form inflorescence to make them visible. The flowers pollinated by flies and beetles secrete foul odors to attract these animals. The pollen grains are generally sticky. When the animals comes in contact with the anthers and the stigma, its body get pollens. When it comes in contact with stigma, it results in pollination. Here, look at in figure how the animals or insects involves in the pollination. Zoophily. Rather than the insects, reptiles, birds, rodents are also involving in the pollination. So due to this environmental change and adaptivity, so some flower became completely adapted to a rodents, birds and some reptiles. Outbreeding devices. Hermaphrodite flowers can undergo self-pollination. Continued, self-pollination results in inbreeding depression. To avoid self-pollination and encourage cross-pollination, there are some devices in plants. First one, dichogamy, avoiding synchronization. Here, the pollen is released before the stigma becomes receptive. Before the release of pollen, it prevents autogamy. In such kind of a device, so flowers may be protoandrous or protogynous. Protoandrous means the anthers are firstly produced, and protogynous means gynoecium is firstly produced. Hercogamy. So both anthers and the stigma are placed in a different position and they cannot come into contact with each other. So without contact each other, they can produce the flowers. Self-sterility or self-incompatibility. It is a genetic mechanism to prevent self-pollen from fertilization by inhibiting pollen germination or pollen tube growth in the pistil. Dicliny or unisexuality. Production of unisexual flowers. If male and female flowers are present on the same plant, it prevents autogamy but not gynotogamy. In dioecious plants, male and female flowers are present on different plants. This prevents both autogamy and gynotogamy. Conclusion for today's session. Summary. Today we discuss about the self-pollination, in that autogamy, the types of flowers, chasmogamous and clistogamous flowers. Third one, cross-pollination, in that gynotogamy and xenogamy. And last one, the pollinating agents. They are abiotic and biotic agents. And we also discussed about dichogamy and hercogamy, self-sterility or self-incompatibility, and last one, unisexuality or dichliny. And thanks for your patience and have a good day.